Hello, everybody. It's Michelle Lloyd here, founder of United Art Space. And we have a very, very amazing guest, Maria Brophy, who has amazing internet connection today, everybody. I'm so sorry about the other day. It couldn't be helped. We think it was the weather conditions over in where Maria lives. So it's all fixed. So we're going to have an amazing conversation with Maria. Welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm so glad like everything's working today. Yeah, now we can relax and we can have fun and
And then if you have any questions as we're going along, please fire them in. I will check the comments as they're coming in. But let me introduce Maria. First of all, she is author of this amazing book, Art, Money and Success. It's an Amazon bestseller. And she, for over 20 years, has traveled the world coaching creatives. She's helped artists to grow their business. She owns an art gallery in California, and she is an agent to her husband, Drew Brophy. Now, if you've been in my community, you will have heard me talk about Maria and Drew a lot because I am massive, massive fans. I think they are both adorable, inspiring, and they're just, well, as we talk, you'll know, you'll understand how they just live life on their own terms. So, thank you. And I just want to point out, I did this the other day, but some people probably didn't see it, how many pages I've earmarked in this book. Can you see that?
I can see it. Makes me so happy because that's what I want people to do. I want people to like write in it and take notes and have a journal to go with it, which a lot of people do. Yeah. Well, that tells me that you're doing the work, you're paying attention, and that it's actually valuable.
It's full of gold. It's full of gold. And I just want to say, if you're a hub member, we are using Maria's book inside the hub during book club, which is going to be for the next 3 months. So you're going to have plenty of time to go and buy the book and we will read it together. And Maria is coming back to do a special Q&A about the book. Yep. So we're going to sort that out later. So that's great. So what I thought we'd do is talk about the three topics on Maria's front page, art, money and success, and fire away questions as we go along. Of course, the event is Your Art Matters. So what I want to dive into is, first of all, generally why art matters in the world, but also why, I was saying this the other day, how we can sit here saying why art matters, why it's so important for you to have your own voice and why it impacts other people. But I can guarantee there'll still be people sitting there thinking, but my artwork doesn't speak to anyone or my artwork is rubbish. So let's talk about that, Maria, because you've worked with so many artists, haven't you? And that seems to be one of the biggest things that gets in their way.
Yeah, and you know, here's the thing. Your art, whether it impacts one person or a million people, it matters. Now, you know, I could go on and on and on with my personal belief system as to where I come up with that. But you think about, if you look at history and how art impacts people and how it impacts politics and how it impacts history and culture. And my husband always says this one thing. He said, you know, artists see the world in a different way. And so it's almost like it's the job of the artist to show people a perspective that maybe they otherwise wouldn't see. So whether your art is funny and parody, or if it's serious, if it takes on serious subjects or playful subjects, all of that is important and it's a part of our culture.
Yeah, it is. And I liked what you were saying the other day about you just need to make art that really lights you up as well. Yeah. People get distracted with making art that they think someone else will like. Or maybe this will sell. And actually, when you go back to just what is your own voice and what is that passion inside of you, then it pours out, doesn't it?
Yeah, the other day I was working with an artist and she's just really getting started with selling her work. And she was saying, well, I don't know if I should, you know, go in this direction with my art and create these images, or if I should do this, or if I should do this. And there were all these different directions she could go in, right? And I said, well, out of all those things that you just mentioned, what is it that excites you the most? And she said, well, I really love angels because I'm a Christian and I'm very spiritual and angels are very important to me. But I don't really think I should go in that direction because not everybody loves angels and not everybody has the same, you know, spiritual point of view as me. And I said, look, if that's what excites you, then do that, because that's when you're going to do your best work. It's when you're going to wake up at like 4 a.m. and go, oh my gosh, I've got this, you know, I had a dream about this angel and I've got to paint this painting. And that's when you're going to do your most meaningful work for yourself. And trust me, there are millions of people in the world that love angels. And there's probably millions of people that don't love angels, but it doesn't matter. You're not here to create art to make everybody happy. You're really here to create art that inspires you, that you're inspired by, and that you're driven by. And then the people who love those things that you love will find you.
Yeah, so well said. So well said. And there's nothing better than making art that you really are passionate about and finding those people. It's just the best feeling in the world. So choose what's in you is what I say. Yeah. We've got some great questions coming in. Stacey James has asked, how do you adjust to being okay with earning more money or megabucks? So this is a great one from Maria and Drew. Have grown a huge business, you know, multiple six-figure business through licensing and through all sorts. So let's, yeah, fire over. Let's hear what you have to say on that.
Okay, well, there are two kinds of people in the world when it comes to money. One is the people that grew up with money and they have really healthy relationship with money, and money is never a problem for them. It's never a problem for them to ask for money and be paid a lot of money. I envy those people because then the second kind of people is what I am. And it's the people who grew up with a slight dysfunction with money or a big dysfunction with money. And I grew up poor, so I really had to overcome a lot of money issues. But there are a lot of people out there that didn't grow up poor and they still have a dysfunction with money, because you don't have to be poor to have a money dysfunction. It could be your parents had a dysfunction with money and they passed it on to you, because that's usually where we get these issues with money. So how do you adjust from a money dysfunction to being okay with earning it? You do it in steps. For the first thing you do is you say, okay, I have to realize that I need money to feed myself and my family and to pay for my art supplies and everything else that I need. So money is not a bad thing because everybody's doing it, right? I mean, in the world we live in, you have to have money. And so that's not going to change anytime soon, maybe not in our lifetime. So that's one thing that you have to realize. And then the next thing is you have to say, okay, so my work is valuable. And you have to just look, you have to just make the decision to learn how to be comfortable with money, with accepting money. Okay, and then that brings me to another thought. Well, the way I look at money is it's really an exchange. Like your art is valuable, right? And money is also valuable. So when someone gives you money in exchange for your art, it's a fair exchange of value. And you could even look at money as love, right? So if somebody loves your art, they're going to give you money so that they can own what you created. And I look at it that way. And it does take some practice if that's hard for you to wrap your head around. So I do know this, that people tend to not value what they don't have to pay for. And that is a fact. So just giving your art away, it's not going to be valued. It's not going to be valued as much. It's not going to be respected as much. So, I think that goes for everything. You know, you think about all the stuff that you get for free. Do you value it as much as something that you had to make an exchange for?
Yeah. I remember when you last came in as a guest, I remember you giving some advice that stuck with me. And that's that you should never, I can't remember how you phrased it, but you should never, your own perception of money, you should never put that into your art, because what your perception of expensive is not someone else's perception of expensive. And that was just like, wow, amazing advice, because you're so right. You know what, £100, dollars, euros to you might be really expensive, but to someone else it's a drop in the ocean. And so you shouldn't judge that either. That just reminded me of that amazing advice. I thought I'd bring that back in there.
And I did write about that in the book somewhere. And, you know, and I learned that from someone else. So there was a course that I took, oh my gosh, years and years ago, called Go for No. And it was a course about how to sell, right? And so, and I bought, back then you bought DVDs of these courses. So I bought this DVD set. And that was the big lesson that I got out of there was, okay, if you are only comfortable spending $50 on a dress, right? Because that's your limit. And then you find yourself in a job where you're selling dresses. Don't assume that every customer that walks in is only going to spend $50 on a dress. There are women that spend $1,000 on a dress, and it's not a big deal to them. So you can't put your own limits on your customer. And so, like in art, I'm trying to think how much I've ever spent on a piece of art. I'm sure I personally have not spent more than, I don't know, $500 on a piece of art. I don't even know. I'd have to think about it. But I can't assume that every customer that walks into this gallery has that same limit. And they don't, because I have sold $10,000 paintings. And the people I've sold them to didn't think twice about it. And they didn't walk in looking like somebody that would spend $10,000. They look like everybody else. So you just can't assume that. And you can't place those limits on your customer.
Yeah, yeah. Whilst we're talking about money, a great question came in the other day, and I thought I'd fire this one over to you. So building up your audience and selling can take time. And sometimes artists need the cash right now. And do you have any tips for those people who are starting out, but they need to make the quick sales, they need some money coming in? Do you have any advice for people at those stages where they just need a cash injection and they're still their audience?
And my advice, this advice, anybody can use it, but I'll focus it on a beginner. So if you are just new to selling art, here's what make sales. You start posting things on social media. You make it clear that this item is for sale. Okay. You text or call people who have shown interest in your work. Now, this is hard for a lot of people. And, but hey, selling is hard. But selling is an active act. Selling is not sitting back and hoping somebody emails you or sends you a message. You have to actively take action. And here is something interesting, that once you make one sale, it's sort of like, pushing a snowball down a hill, right? You start with a small one and then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger as it goes. It's momentum. You get momentum. Once you start making sales, you make your first sale, your next sale is going to come quicker and easier and so on and so on. And it kind of gets fun because now you're like, oh my gosh, I can actually do this. And then you get inspired and you get excited and you have to allow yourself to enjoy the sale. And the sale is not just about money. It's about bringing joy to the person who's buying the art. So a friend of mine has only sold one painting in her life and up until yesterday. So yesterday she posted a photo on her Instagram of a painting that she was working on. And her mother had just died a few months ago. And this painting was, it's very abstract reminder of her mother. And it's very meaningful to her. She showed it on Instagram and someone that she sort of knew, a friend of a friend, sent her a message saying, I love that painting. I want to buy it. How much is it? And she had no idea what to charge for it. And she just blurted out $500. And the person said, okay, I want it. And so she's shipping it today. And she sent me a message saying, oh my gosh, I can't believe I sold this painting. And all I did was post a picture of it. And, you know, and I had this message exchange back and forth. And she's now just fired up about it. But it's as simple as that. Just sharing your work, showing it, telling a little story about it, telling people it's available. And if you're new to selling, now a lot of art consultants will not like what I'm about to tell you, but I'm going to tell you, don't come out the gate with a huge price. Come out with a price that your buyer can say yes to and start that way and get momentum. And as time goes on, you can raise your prices.
Yeah, it's so true, isn't it? Like you said, if you think about the snowball and the confidence that you get and the social proof that you've sold from those first few sales, it builds all of that up inside of you and you can put the red dots on rather than go way, way high and then not selling and you're deflated and you're having to slash prices. I always say the same. I love what you just said there as well about reminding people. And this is really scary for some people. And you're great at this because you talk about this in your book about reaching out to people. Because actually, people are busy and we forget that. We think people are hunting artwork, but they're not. They're not. So just dropping someone a message saying, hey, you liked my work. Just wanted to let you know I've just put some new pieces up. You can say it in a really authentic, genuine way, can't you? Just prod people. And I think so many people are scared to do that.
Yeah. And, you know, and know that not everything is going to be a seller and you have to be okay with that. So just in the last 2 weeks, we came out with some new art prints of work that my husband did a couple years ago, but we had never made it available in prints. And it's these two paintings that I thought for sure we're just going to sell like crazy, right? I thought these prints were going to sell. We put them at affordable prices. We kept it under $50 and crickets. Nobody's buying. And my husband and I both are kind of confused. We're like, gosh, I thought for sure people were going to love this. And I said, okay, well, let's not take it personally. We can't get our feelings hurt for whatever reason. We think it's great, but nobody else does. Okay, that's fine. So then we came out with a new line of handmade leather goods. And if you can see, let's see, I don't have any that I can grab from my chair, but a couple are belts hanging behind me. But we came out with these very expensive leather goods. The belts are $125 each. The wallets are $200 each. And honestly, I didn't think we'd make a lot of sales because it's just a lot of money. And I don't know, you know, I just didn't know. We've never done it before. I started posting on my, I handle my husband's Instagram, but we share it. So I started posting on his Instagram story. Hey, here's a new wallet. Here's a new belt. Next thing you know, people are sending messages. How much is it? And I say $200. And some people are like, oh, that's a little too much. But in one day, I sold four wallets for $200 each, and then sold some belts. And So you just don't know until you try. And when one thing doesn't sell, don't get discouraged. Just try other things, and you're going to hit on something.
Yeah. Yeah. You've got it. It's trial and error and learning and just putting things out there and not being afraid for those crickets. And I hope you all get reassured here by listening. Maria and Drew have been doing this for decades, and still they've released something and got crickets. Take that as assurance that it happens to everybody. It doesn't matter how successful you are, you'll try something and it just might not work, and that's okay. So thank you for sharing that, because I'm sure people are sitting there thinking, oh, it even happens to the Brophies.
Trust me, it happens.
It's easy to see on the outside, isn't it, that everything's going well for you and everyone else, and I'm the one struggling. So yeah, it's important to remember that behind the scenes, there's things not working for people. And I'm just thinking about the snowball again, because I just wanted to add as well to that at the beginning, it can feel like hard work, and it is hard work, isn't it? You know, you've got to keep posting and approaching. But did you find this, that like the snowball, it becomes less and less effort to a point because you start to get organic referrals, and, you know, and people start to recommend you, and a connection comes from a connection. Did you find that where you guys were starting out?
Absolutely. And I'm going to say the most important thing is the relationships that you develop with people. And it's really important to respond to people. When somebody shows interest in your work, even if they're not buying it, respond. Develop a relationship with them, whether it's online or personally by text, through your email newsletters, however it works for you. As time goes on, you will have a number of fans that will buy anything from you, or that will buy almost everything you put out. And those are the people you want to show a lot of love to. Those are the people that you have in your phone, and you can text them and say, hey, I just came out with something new and I thought you might be interested. And if they're interested, great. And if they're not, never let it bother you. And I had this happen this past week with the belts and the wallets. There were a couple people that I texted saying, hey, you know, I know that you like this particular style, and I thought you might be interested. Do you want me to send you a couple pictures? And some people ignore me, or they're just busy and don't respond. Other people are like, yeah, send me a couple photos. So then I send them a couple photos, and you know, that's how you do it. And I know it is a lot of work, but that's how it's done. The relationships are everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Really crucial. And you're great at that, aren't you? I read that in your book, and you can tell that you do put a lot of work in building relationships up with people. There's a question here from Channeling. I've been asked to do a few commissions, but I'm scared to do them because of the fear of failing. How do you overcome the fear?
You can't let the fear stop you. You can't let it stop you. And what's the worst that can happen? The worst that can happen is the customer hates it, right? That is the worst thing. And it's a terrible thing. And, you know, there's a tiny chance that's going to happen, right? So here's what you do. You tell yourself, if the customer hates it, and they don't want it, I will not make them take it. I will not make them pay for it. I'll refund their money. Okay? That's the worst thing that can happen. Yeah. And then what comes out of that is you learn something. So you ask the customer, if in the very rare case that they hate it, you say, please give me feedback. What could I have done better? Or what if I create another piece that you'll love? Now, I don't recommend doing this as a regular practice, but if you're brand new to commissions, use the commissions as a way to get better at what you do and a way to get paid while you're getting better at what you do. Okay? But don't be afraid to go into it and look at it as practice. So, you know, I'll give you an example. I've actually written 6 books, and out of all 6 books, only one, and it's my Art Money Success book, is a success. And I don't look at the other 5 books as a waste of time. And let me tell you, they were a lot of time, and I spent money having them edited and, you know, having a book cover made. So I lost money on those other 5 books, but I never look at it as a waste of time. It was necessary for me to get better at writing. So you have to look at your paintings, your sculptures, whatever you're doing in that same way. It's never a waste of time.
Yeah, all adds up to the journey. There's a great question here from Mark. With all the success, do you find there's more pressure to succeed or move forward?
For me personally, the pressure is myself, because I'm highly motivated and I'm always inspired by new ideas, and it's just the way my brain is wired. Pressure from other people is mental, and I never feel pressure from other people, and I'm grateful for that, because I don't care what other people are doing. You know, like my peers, I never look at other people as competition. And sometimes I find myself getting envious or feeling that way. And then I remind myself, no, there is no competition when it comes to art or when it comes to writing or whatever. So you just, if you find yourself feeling pressure to live up to somebody else's idea of success, you have to get a handle on that. You have to learn to think for yourself and only give life to your own desires. Don't live up to other people's, and don't follow other people's, and don't worry about what other people are doing.
I love that. I just want to talk now about a blog post that you wrote. I'm not sure when it was, but this whole concept of success and the definition of success, I think, is important. And I remember when I was reading one of your blogs, you had a dinner party, I think, and there was a doctor, I might be getting some of this a bit wrong, there was a doctor who was listening to you saying, you know, we're going traveling next month. And this doctor, whoever it was, said, I wish I could live like that. And you said, you can. It was as simple as that.
There's nothing stopping you other than yourself. And this idea that you have to do what you think you have to do. It's all in your head.
Yeah.
And, you know, I grew up I had a terrible childhood. I'm just going to say my father was physically abusive, mentally abusive. And for a long time, I felt like I missed out on I felt like I was gypped, that I missed out because I didn't have parents that cared about me, right? But now, all these years later, I think to myself, there's one really good thing that came out of that, and that is I learned to think for myself, because nobody was telling me what to do. Because nobody cared about me enough to tell me what to do. And that really has worked to my benefit. And I do believe that you can reprogram your mind to come up with new belief systems that enable you to let go of those things that hold you back. And some of those things that hold you back are thinking that you have to do things a certain way, thinking that you have to follow certain rules, that you need to have what everybody else has, and you don't. You don't. I mean, if you look at, you know, I have a friend that lives out of his van. One day, about 5 years ago, he said, you know what? I am tired of the rat race. I don't need to have a house. I don't need to work my tail off to live here in Southern California, where it's very expensive, just to live the way everybody thinks I need to live. So he got rid of his apartment. He got rid of all his belongings. He turned his van into like this cute little mobile home. And he lives out of it. And he is so happy. And there are people that look at him and say, gosh, you know, people think he's had family members call him a loser or whatever. And he said, you know what? I don't care what they think. I'm happy. I'm surfing every day and I don't have any pressure anymore. And, you know, I say, live the way you want to live. If you want to have a giant house and expensive cars and it requires you to work really, really hard and that really makes you happy, then do it. But there are so many different ways to live and you have to be true to yourself.
Yeah, this is what I love about you and your family, because you really do live life on your own terms. And it was so eye-opening for me when I first came across you, and I was coming across a few other people that were doing the same thing, and I was like, wow, who are these people that live life on their own terms? Because I'd had a similar upbringing, and you know, we were told you have to do a job that you don't like, that's what you're going to have to do, and yeah, that's what you do, and you get on with it, and you just don't complain, just roll your sleeves up, get on with it, and work in a factory. And so when I came across you and a few other people online, I was like, whoa, it was really eye-opening. And I think a lot from what I saw from the way you lived your life, and when you came to do a session, we've got a session inside of our hub membership, which is Living the Dream, which is one of your resources that you wrote a long time ago, still really, really relevant. And it's about defining that success. And that was a big game changer for me. And for me now, my success is not necessarily about how much money I earn. You know, I still have financial goals and I'm reaching them, but it's about having freedom in my life.
Yeah.
And there was something I might have read in the book as well, where you said, you know, you can strip back and live on less.
Yeah.
And you don't need all the things if you don't need the things. And as simple as it sounds, I was like, yeah, I would rather be able to get up with my kids and work when I want than have all the things. And so that's how I define my success now. If I can get up every day and do what I want, then I'm succeeding.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's too easy to get caught up in a rat race of what you think you need to do every day. And then next thing you know, a year's gone by and you haven't had a vacation. And then another year goes by and then 10 years go by and you would say to yourself, oh my gosh, like I haven't taken care of my body. I haven't gone and traveled and I haven't done anything. And it's really easy for people to get stuck in a rut like that. And so it's important that you do the work and you do the art and you do that stuff, but you also have to schedule in the things that make you really happy, whether it's traveling or hiking or dog training. I don't know, you know, everybody's got something they want to do. And this life just goes so fast and it seems to be going faster.
Yeah. And you do this as a family, don't you? You go away. Yeah. Multiple times a year, you take like a big break away,
and that's sometimes we take off for months.
Wow.
And you know what we do? We just shut our business down, or we kind of do a combo of shut the business down, do work on the road, do some work on the road, And, you know, and I've had accountants tell me, oh, you guys shouldn't be doing that. You lose a lot of money every time you do that. And I say, well, what am I working for? If not to live this really cool life now. I mean, I'm not going to wait till I'm 70 to do it. It's my body might not work as well when I'm 70. I mean, I hope it does, but it might not. I can't count on that. And I like to do active things. I like to paddleboard and surf and backpack and hike. And I like to climb trees. I mean, I love to do all that stuff. And I don't know how long I'll be able to do it. So I got to do it now.
Yeah. Just on the back of that, have you got any advice? Because I know there's probably people sitting here thinking, wow, that is so brave. There's probably people sitting here that have built their art businesses up to a certain level, and they're so afraid to do what you've done, to take a step back, because there'll be a lot of people thinking, I've got to this point, I don't want to jeopardize it, and what if I can't get back to that? So how do you manage that in terms of like the mindset, but also the practicalities as well? Do you have a strategy for getting back into it after you've been away? And
you're not going to lose anything. I mean, you might lose some money. You might have to defer some opportunities, but you're not going to lose your who you are and what you're known for. I mean, that's, you take a month off or a week off or 3 months off. I mean, no matter what you do, if you're traveling, you still can be connected. I mean, unless you're going in the woods somewhere where there's no Wi-Fi, which happens to me every now and again. But, you know, you're not.
Yeah.
You can still stay connected to people, you know.
Yeah. But I do look.
I'm going to turn my chimes off. Hang on 1 second.
Yeah, that's okay. Say, because I love it when Maria, I'm on Maria's email list, and she'll send a message saying, we're all
sorry, forgot to take that out. Out of the
it was nice and peaceful and relaxing. I was just saying how I've been on your email list for a while, and I love when I get those messages that say, hey, just letting you know, we're off. You won't hear from us for a while. You can follow our journey on Instagram, and it's so refreshing. It's like, wow, you know, you're just owning that and just, yeah, not apologizing. Like, we are closing down for a little while and we'll be back soon and you can follow us here. I just think it's great.
Well, and something miraculous happens every time we go on a trip. We end up meeting people. We end up getting new opportunities that we probably wouldn't have gotten if we didn't go on the trip. So in 2009, which is a really long time ago, 2009, we went to New Zealand for a month, and it was purely vacation. And we rented a van called Escape Camper Vans. And this company, they rent out these camper vans that are hand painted by artists. So we show up and we get our van, and the owner comes out and greets us. And he said, Drew, Brophy, I know you. I've seen your art. And gosh, if I knew you were coming, I would have had a van for you to paint. He said, I would love to have you and your family over for dinner one night. So anyway, so we meet the owner of Escape Camper Vans. We go to his house for dinner. And he said, well, you know, we're actually opening up a Los Angeles location, and would love to have you be our first artist and help us get started in the United States. And so we ended up getting this great opportunity just from going on vacation for a month. And Drew ended up painting over the course of, I don't know how many years, since 2009, almost 100 camper vans. And then we have this great relationship with them now. And it was just amazing. So, you know, and there have been other times when we've gone on vacation and we meet somebody and Drew says, yeah, I'm an artist. And they're like, oh, you know, and we end up getting a mural painting project or other things. So something about just getting out and changing up your routine can get you new opportunities.
Yeah. And now, hopefully, fingers crossed, we're coming out of the pandemic in some way, shape or form, where we'll be able to travel again soon. So yeah, it's amazing, isn't it? And I think just taking a step back and having that clarity. I remember, actually, I have to say a big thank you. My husband at the time, you gave him some advice. It was years ago. He was made redundant. And it was when you came in as a guest and I sneaked his question in. And he was like, I don't know what to do. I've been made redundant and I don't know what direction to go in. And you gave him the advice to stop asking the questions. Just stop asking and allow this, just, you know, just allow space, because you're never going to find the answers if you keep asking what. And it was such amazing advice, because he did that, took his foot off the pedal after 6 months of like stress, and then an opportunity came just a couple of weeks after.
That makes me so happy to hear that. I had no idea.
I've been meaning to tell you, and I always wanted to share that with you. So I'm just glad I remembered about that, because you've had a big impact on him. So thank you. And it was, and it's still something now he reverts back to, and myself. So we have a question coming in from Maria. I bet you get this one a lot. I do. How do you determine the price for a painting?
$1 million question.
Yeah. we need a whole other session for pricing.
Well, I mean, we could talk about this question for an hour. Let's see. Okay, if you are new to pricing your work, you know, pricing is all over the board. I mean, it depends on the size of the painting, the theme, what your customer base is, what kind of materials you use. Some artists use very expensive materials and some use the cheapest. You know, it's all over the board. But in general, I would say it's best to come up with a formula, either a per square. Well, in the US, we use inches. We're like still in the Stone Ages. But I guess, you know, the rest of the world uses centimeters, right?
Yeah.
So per linear. Yeah. But come up with a price structure that makes sense per size. Now, if you're like, well, where do I even start with that? I recommend looking at other artists that create in a similar theme to a similar market, using similar medium. And kind of get an idea of what they're charging and base it off of that. It's kind of what everybody does, no matter what business you're in. If you're in the business of selling, you know, computer mouses, that's what you're going to do. You're going to look at the market, see what they're selling for. Look at yours and how it differs. Is yours made with, you know, more valuable because of something than you would charge more for it? Is it, you know, less valuable because something you charge less? I mean, I know that's kind of general, but that's, you have to just start somewhere. And if you're brand new, go a little bit lower, get momentum, and raise your prices as you sell your work. Just keep raising and raising and raising.
It's about just getting going, isn't it? Get a price on it, get going and learn from doing, I think is the best. And like what Maria said, just gather as much information as you can to inform your decision. But ultimately, it's just get a price. You'll soon learn whether it's too expensive or too cheap when you start getting yourself out there. Les has asked, and I think we've answered this already, what about if you've never sold a piece of work before? How do you put it out there?
Social media, just post it. I am a huge believer in doing things in person, live. Now, I know that there are restrictions depending on where you are in the world, but they're starting to lift in a lot of places. And I know in the US, we have a lot of places where there's no restrictions at all. But if you can do an art show or be a part of an art show or hang your work in a public place, That is the ideal way to get started. I really believe that seeing art in person is really more effective than online, unless you have a massive following. But just get it out there. Get it out there. Here's another thing that you could do. If you're in a place that's pretty locked down, maybe do what you're allowed to do by law, private parties. Ask a friend or somebody that you know that loves your art, that would want to support you. Ask them to give you a small, intimate, private showing and show your work. And start there. Get comfortable with showing it and talking to people about it.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you'll start to build that snowball.
Yeah. And you can do that in people's homes. You can do it in small businesses. There's a lot of, you know, start just asking yourself the question, where could I show my work? And who would be the perfect person to ask to host it for me? There are people that are going to want to help you out.
Yeah. Mostly he's asking, what I tend to struggle with is the emotional connection to what I make. I don't want to let my sculptures go. Oh, I get this one a lot. Yeah, you've built this attachment to them, but I do want to sell the piece. What can I do? Does that ever happen to Drew? Does he ever get attached to something and not want to let it go? Or
he is only attached to one painting, just one. And he is letting me sell it if it sells, but he doesn't want me to sell it.
Yeah.
His philosophy is this. He wants to see it go into people's homes to make people happy. And he also says that when a piece goes out the door, it leaves mental space for him to create new work. So he does want to see it go. So for somebody who has trouble letting it go, maybe you could change your mental perspective a little bit and imagine your art bringing a lot of joy to someone else and wanting to give that gift to people.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of people asking about business licenses, but I think it does depend what country you live in. So I'm not sure I'm going to give that one to Maria, because really you need to check the country that you're in.
Check your city, your local city. Yeah, it's different everywhere.
Yeah, because the question was, what do I do if I can't afford the business license that I need and I need to start selling?
Gosh, yeah. And, you know, business licenses are really cheap in some places and really expensive in others. So it does depend on where you are. If you haven't sold anything yet, I wouldn't worry about it, because you really don't have a business until you've sold something. So I would say, you know, and again, I'm not an attorney, so I don't know, maybe legally this isn't right. I have no idea. But most artists that I know, they don't get the business license until they sell something, because they're not sure how it's going to go. And yeah. I mean, I know a lot of artists that sell and they don't even get a business license, but you really, you know, you don't, if you're consistently selling, you need to do it legally. Otherwise, you're going to get in trouble.
Yeah. I think that's great advice. I think check, because there must be some leeway in terms of, you know, if you haven't made a sale yet, because that's the whole point of it. But
yeah.
One thing I would say, in the past when I've really wanted something, if I've wanted a course, if I've wanted to do something, I've sold stuff. I've gone through all my things and I've just gone, and you know, you'll be surprised what you could just quickly sell if you want to just grab that license. I don't know if that's any use, but old books, anything. So yeah, good luck anyway. There's a question here from Alison. I would like to give up my part-time job completely to focus on studio time, but I'm not sure what stage I need to be at before I take that plunge. It's a bit of a catch-22 when I'm working and I'm making less art. any advice when you're in that limbo stage? Yeah, it's a great question. I know there's a lot of people probably in that same stage where they just don't want to take the plunge and lose that consistent revenue that's coming in and supporting them.
Yeah. Well, I don't think it's wise to quit your job if you're not making money off your art yet. I think it's smarter to transition slowly at first. So one artist that I was working with, he's an engineer, and he came to me and he said, look, I sell a little bit of art, but I'm working a full-time job and I only have time on the weekends. And I know, you know, that I want to be full-time in art. So I said, well, why don't you do this? Since you're already selling a little bit, we know that you can sell your work. Why don't you go to your boss and ask them if you can take a pay cut, a 20% pay cut, and cut back to 4 days a week? And he did that. And they said yes, and they cut him back to 4 days a week. So now he was creating art for 3 days a week. And he did increase his income. Then he cut back on his job to 3 days a week. And I mean, it wasn't even a year before he totally quit his job as an engineer and has been a full-time artist. So transition slowly, feel it out, set a goal for yourself. Say, you know, it's a good goal to say, you know, in 1 year, I want to be making enough money with my art to quit my full-time job. And between now and then, this is how much money I need to bring in with my art, and have it figured out. How much money do you need to bring in every month with your art? And then break that down by week and break it down by day. And once you understand what the numbers are that you need to do, that you need to make in sales, then you can focus on making those sales and you'll know. So I've worked with artists that said, you know, I need to make, here, I'm going to get my calculator, $4,000 a month. Okay. This is US dollars, but you know, let's see. Divide that by 4 weeks. So that's $1,000 a week divided by five. That's $200 a day if you're working 5 days a week. Start focusing on making $200 a day or $1,000 a week. And for some artists, that's selling one painting a week. For others, it's selling five paintings a week. So you have to just play around with the numbers and understand what it is you need to make and set that as your goal and start working towards it. And understand this, if you're already making money with your art, but you still rely on that other income, just know that as soon as you put all your energy into your art, you're going to increase your income. It's going to happen.
Yeah. And also, just to add on the back of that, sometimes your situation right now, when you're looking at your numbers and how much you're charging, isn't the future. Right. So you might look at your numbers now thinking, I can't make a living selling my art like this. It's never going to happen. But your prices might not be those prices in a year's time or 2 years' time or 3 years' time. They might be 10 times the amount. So don't be disheartened if you crunch the numbers and you think this isn't possible, because it is, and you can do more to raise your prices as you start to learn more about creating more desire for your work, more connection, building those relationships, as Maria says, with people. So
that is a great point that you just made. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. It is, and it's happened to us all, and I see it happen to other people as well, where their pricing has shot up. Yeah. So on paper, it didn't seem it was possible, but absolutely has been. There's a question here from Lloyd. Hello, Lloyd. Any advice for someone who isn't particularly good with people and building relationships? So, yeah, I've had quite a lot of people saying this, that I'm not good at speaking. I'm not good at building relationships. So any advice for people who are feeling that way?
Well, the one thing I can say is, you know, believe it or not, I know you guys aren't going to believe this, but I was really, really, really shy the first half of my life. And learning how to talk to people, learning how to do what I'm doing right now, it was really hard for me in the beginning. And I think a lot of people are like, you know, you hear that word social anxiety. I mean, I've had social anxiety and I still do. My answer to that is you just have to practice. And the more conversations you have, the more you do these things, the more it becomes like brushing your teeth, you know, it becomes natural. And you just have to do the things that are a little uncomfortable in the beginning. One trick that I've learned to play on myself when I get nervous about a meeting, like if I have a business meeting, like tomorrow, I have a meeting by Zoom with a very giant company and I'm nervous about it. And I've actually met this guy many times, but I'm still really nervous about it. So the trick I play on myself is I take time to think in my mind, okay, this meeting is not about me. It's not about Drew. It's not about the art. It's about the customer. It's about what he wants, what makes him happy. And I think about this customer as someone that I want to make him feel really good and I want to make him feel important. And when I make that my goal, I find that I'm warmer. Like the way I talk to people is warmer. I'm less worried about how I look or how I sound or how smart I sound, you know, because that's always a worry. Like, am I going to sound stupid? Am I going to sound like I don't know what I'm talking about? And none of that matters if I focus on making that person feel good.
Yeah. Yeah. And like you say, it gets easier and easier. It's like if you're afraid of water the first time you go in it, it's really scary and you might just dip your toe in and then your foot and then eventually you're in the water and it feels fine. And it's the same kind of principle, isn't it? That the more you do it, and just keep stepping a little bit out of depth each time. So don't jump in the deep end without your armbands, but just keep pushing yourself that little bit each time. Thank you so much for joining us, Maria. Thank you to everybody who's tuned in. It's been an amazing discussion. I really want you to take away from this that you have the power to live life on your own terms. You define your definition of success. Get out there, put a price on your work. Get it out there, approach people, and just honor who you are. But know it's possible. It's absolutely possible. So I will put links. Maria's got an amazing blog, really amazing blog. She's got a great Instagram account as well where she goes live. She shares lots of stuff. She's so generous with her time. So I will put all those links. Also, Maria and Drew featured in our magazine, the Your Art Matters magazine. They've got a feature in that magazine. So if you want to read that, if you go to yourartmatters.com, you'll be able to download the magazine. It's free and you'll be able to read their article, which is a great read. I really highly recommend you go and check that out. And so thank you. Thank you so much, Maria.
Thank you.
Can't wait to have you back in when we're inside the hub and we'll all read your book and we'll do
it. Yeah. And can I say one thing about my book real quick? For those of you who don't like to read actual books, my book is also available on Audible. And I don't know if people know that, but you can, it's available as an audio book as well.
Awesome. Thank you for pointing that out.
Yeah.
We'll put all the links to those inside the chat and the comments when I've hung up. Thank you, everybody. Remember that your art really does matter. And thank you again for joining us. If I've missed any comments, I will come back and check them. And have a great day wherever you are. Take care.
Bye, everybody. Bye.